dig into what happened and how Health Canada approved this incredible vaccine. We're now joined by Health Canada's chief medical advisor, Dr. Supriya Sharma. Dr. Sharma, first of all, congratulations to you and your team. It was wonderful to see you make that historic announcement today. You were beaming, and I think the rest of the country was beaming. Can you tell us how this remarkable approval process came so quickly? How did it happen?
Well, really, the approval process was one part of it. So we did get this review, the submission in October, but the work around, you know, the regulatory review of these vaccines started as soon as we knew that a vaccine was in development. So we started working internationally with other regulators. We started working with the scientific community to learn more about the vaccine development, what types of candidates were being looked at. So we already had a lot of that work, and we started looking at the research. And then we received the vaccine, and we had a dedicated team of fantastic reviewers and scientists that worked around the clock and worked on information as it became available to get us to the point where we can now say that the benefits of this vaccine outweigh the potential risks. We've got terms and conditions on the license to continue and to monitor it and follow it. But at this point in time, it's authorized and it can be used in Canada.
Okay. And you talked about the rolling review. Trust is a big issue. I mean, there's almost two pandemics, right? The horrific health pandemic and the pandemic of distrust that comes. Can you tell people, given the emergency needs here, that the process to approve this as quickly as it was not rushed in any way, or that no safety standards in any way were bypassed? Can you assure Canadians of all that?
I can 100% say to Canadians that they should have confidence in this review process, and that although it is a shortened review process, we do not cut any corners, and we're holding these vaccines to the same standards as other vaccines. And as you said, Evan, you know, I think we're dealing with a pandemic, but we're also dealing with a bit of an infodemic. There's a lot of information out there. But Canadians can have faith to know that no vaccinations will be rolled out until it has Health Canada review, and that Health Canada review is a really rigorous process. It's science and evidence-based. We do not look at anything else, and we will only authorize it if it meets standards.
We're seeing these, as Avis just talked about, in investigations in the UK into allergic reactions caused by the vaccine. We understand that Pfizer never tested these vaccines on people who have the kind of allergies where they might have to carry an EpiPen. First of all, why then was that administered, and what are you advising Canadians on this?
So just to clarify, in terms of the studies, Pfizer did not exclude people with all allergies from those studies. So the people that were excluded from the studies are people with a history of an allergic reaction to another vaccine. So there may have been people in the studies with allergies to food or other medications, for example, and we're getting more information from Pfizer to see if we can get some more granularity on that. So that's one thing. And then in those studies, there were only two people that had severe allergic reactions. One was in the group that got the vaccine, one was not. And the one for the person that got the vaccine, it doesn't look like it was related to the vaccine. So it wasn't something that was showing up in clinical trials, but it's always a possibility with the vaccine. You know, it's an injection of a substance, and we know that people can have allergic reactions to that. That's why when you get a vaccine, you have to be there and you stay in that place for, you know, at least 15 to 20 minutes. People who've gotten the influenza vaccine know that they have to stay around where they get that. Right. And so it's not uncommon that allergic reactions happen, but the idea is that we need to go take a look at these cases and see if we can get more details about them and see if there's any changes that we need to make for the use of the vaccine in Canada.
Yeah, and you're making a great point. You get the flu shot, and people should. You wait 15 minutes in the pharmacy just to make sure there's no reaction. The other question I've been getting when I did our radio show on this just after your announcement is people were concerned about the long-term impacts. How does this study, which happened so fast, figure out if there are long-term impacts on the vaccine? What do you say to Canadians asking about that?
So on safety and adverse events in general, I think it's important to put that in context. So 95% of all adverse reactions related to a vaccine happen within the first 42 days of getting that vaccine. And so that's why these were, you know, the average time that people were followed after the vaccination was 2 months. But it's, you know, we put terms and conditions on the license, so the company has to continue to follow them. We have reports that will be coming in after 6 months. And then we have people that will be in these trials that will be followed for 2 years. So that's one part of it. So all the information will be coming in from the company. We're also working with others internationally. So, you know, you're right, as it gets rolled out and the vaccine gets used by millions of people, very rare side effects can come up. And we can, you know, work with other international regulators to make sure that those are identified. We have a relatively small population here in Canada. And then the most important part of it is that we do have a system in Canada to monitor people that are getting vaccines and to see how they're doing and if anything else comes up there. So all of that's happening. We do monitor them, but all of this is after there's been a ton of research leading up to this point. And in the context of, you know, vaccines where we already don't accept a very high level of adverse reactions because they're given to healthy people.
Okay, let me move now to timelines. And I really appreciate the assurances on the safety of the process. Health Canada released a chart today that we'll show our viewers right now, that talked about the percentage of Canadians. This is the lower chart here, folks. If you can't read it, if it's small, it says the percentage of Canadian population that will able to be vaccinated. It says by the end of June or the second quarter, 40 to 50% of Canadians will be vaccinated. Then it says by Q3 there, the second quarter, the third quarter, 100%. Now the third quarter is the end of September. And so is that right? So Health Canada is now expecting 50% of Canadians, up to 50% by the end of June, and almost every Canadian will get a vaccination by the end of September?
So that's the hope in terms of the rollout, and that's based on, you know, estimates and modeling on what we think we're going to be able to get in terms of vaccine supply and then being able to roll those out. You know, we were thinking by September looking at potentially 80% or all the way to 100% of the people that are vaccinated, but that's really kind of the timelines. That is all contingent on Canadians, you know, trusting the vaccine, accepting it, and being, you know, agreeing to be vaccinated, of course.
Right, but and the key is once, if there's approvals and maybe other vaccines, rolling those out. And just on that note, then we're talking about the Pfizer vaccine that's coming in a couple of days. Moderna also, the vaccine is based on nearly the same platform, the same technology, as it were. They also started their approval process around the same time as Pfizer. When could the Moderna vaccine get approved?
So yeah, we have three vaccines under review now that the Pfizer vaccine has been authorized, the Moderna vaccine, the one from AstraZeneca, and the one from Johnson & Johnson. Definitely out of the three, the Moderna is the one that's the most advanced. And as you said, it's a similar type of vaccine. It's an mRNA vaccine like the Pfizer one. We're still waiting for some key information, primarily around manufacturing, to come in. So we're expecting that to come in over the next couple of weeks. When we get that information, we'll be in a better place to say when we're getting close to a potential another authorization.
But we're close. That's interesting. So we're close to that. One other question a lot of folks have, and by the way, I appreciate your time. You can't imagine the appetite for information. Now that we've got the vaccine approved, we understand it gets flown by Pfizer from Belgium. People are saying, wait a second, that's like an 8-hour flight. Can it be here tomorrow? I don't want to get greedy or anything, but we're understanding it takes a couple days to get here. Is there a holdup somewhere as these vaccines go from Belgium to Canada? Mm-hmm. And then how do they get to these 14 distribution sites?
So basically what the company has said is that they would be ready to ship within about 24 hours of the authorization. We're now thinking that first shipment might be going out from Europe on Friday. So it may be arriving, you know, on the weekend. And as you said, there's air travel and then there's land travel to get it into Canada and then get it distributed by air and by land as well to those 14 sites. So that does take some time. It all depends on the shipping and the shipments. And then those sites have already been working through training exercises, the dry run to make sure that they're ready to receive and handle the vaccine, because it needs to be handled with dry ice and in very cold conditions. It has to be stored at minus 80 to minus 60. And so all of that's being prepared. And so basically, if we get a shipment that leaves on Friday, hopefully it'll arrive on the weekend and then potentially be ready to have vaccinations happening early next week after the whole distribution, thawing, remixing, preparing the vaccine happens.
Boy, that's going to be a heck of a day to see that. And let me just ask you one last question, Dr. Sharma. A lot of folks are wondering, this is cool that negative 80, the Pfizer vaccine. Moderna is obviously a little different, and then the other ones that may be approved are different. How long does it take to kind of warm the vaccine up once it's just, you know, it's there at negative 80 before it's administered in people's arms? I got a question on radio the other day saying, wait, I don't want something that's negative 80 being shot into my arm. I know it's not. So what's the process there?
So there's two ways to do it. So basically the vaccine has to be stored between minus 80 and minus 60. It then gets thawed, and there's two ways to thaw it. You can thaw it in a refrigerator, so that's at 2 to 8 degrees. And depending on how many vials you have in the refrigerator, that takes between 2 and 3 hours. You can also thaw it out at room temperature. That only takes about 30 minutes. But then once the product is thawed, you have to, within 2 hours, mix it with something called the diluent, which is like a salt solution, to reconstitute it. Then you, in that one vial, you put some fluid in there, take out, make sure it's pressurized, and then that one vial is 5 doses. And so for each of those doses, once that is reconstituted, so it's thawed, it's reconstituted, you have to administer those doses within 6 hours.
Wow, so that is not a simple process. That's a complicated process, which may explain why they're not moving it around. They're just, all the doses will be administered, at least in the first part, at these 14 distribution sites. Dr. Sharma, thank you for spending so much time. I know you've had an incredibly busy day. Our audience really appreciates getting such a thorough response from you. I know we'll have many more conversations, but congratulations on an extraordinarily important day for the country, and there's a long road ahead, so get some rest, and we'll speak again. Thank you so much, Doc.